Hello, my name is Lauren Hazel, and this is going to be more of an inside look into how I plan things I'm thinking about doing. So if you are an entrepreneur and you are curious as to sort of the back end process of putting things together for sales or putting things together for marketing and trying to automate that system and planning it out, this is it right here. So it might be some nuggets. So, you know, listen up. And, you know, I've been thinking, you know, Black Friday, Cyber Monday are coming up rapidly, and I have a lot of things to do that is not business related. And I want to make the most out of my time. So this weekend, I have to figure out what I'm going to sell to my list for StoryX, BrandX, Strategist.com. You can go on that website. That's one of my main websites. There's a lot of marketing stuff on there, sales stuff. There's some branding stuff on there. Pretty fun website. It's not all serious. If you've ever been to most marketing sites, it's very serious. Mine is not as serious. It shows some of the things that I'm into or believe in. So you can have a lot of fun there. You can read about Star Wars and business. You know, you can look at me criticize startups and ad campaigns and give some really cool advice. So there's the post on there. There's videos. So whether you like to watch video or you like to read posts, that's the place for you. There's also a way to get on my email list on that site. So make sure you hop on the email list. That's where I do the updates on when I do these sorts of things. And then on that site, just to let you know, I talk about things like marketing, of course. I talk about sales. I talk about branding and really storytelling. So a lot of posts have a tie into storytelling and how different brands or companies use it or don't use it and how you might be able to use it. So, but you really need to get on the email list. So StoryX, BrandXStrategist.com. You will see a drawing on me with my hat on with a Star Wars t-shirt and a Yankee hat. So you can have fun on that site. I like to make it very lighthearted. I like to make it in appearance lighthearted because there's a lot of serious stuff going on. And I think, you know, just a break from the normal is not a bad thing. So you can go on there, learn some things, hopefully have some fun, hop on the email list, read some of my crazy emails where I do a lot of email experiments on there, and as well as get access to when I do things like this or when I have something to sell. Such as one of my premier products that will be coming out probably in the next few months, cold email to big clients, which is a product that people have asked me for. I am building that out now. It may not come out till early next year, but the only way you get access and the ability to buy it actually is being on that email list. So if you are a freelancer or a business owner who wants to build that cold email funnel to land some clients, that's going to be the thing for you, but you need to hop on the email list, storyxbrandxstrategist.com, okay? Now that I did the announcement for that, you know, let me take you a little bit into what's going on now. So I haven't been writing so much for my own email list, even though I have like two emails I could have sent out. I didn't, because I've been writing emails for an autoresponder for a separate list that I am doing, and that's going to be for the purpose of attracting people who own e-commerce businesses, so Shopify stores, WooCommerce, that, you know, that bunch. And I'm doing that because I want to, you know, do some more work on that side. So because what's going to wind up happening, so this is what happens when we have multiple email lists. So even if I'm not sending an email to one of my main lists, it's not that I'm not sending emails at all. It's just I have multiple lists that have different sub niches, right? So when you go to storyxbrandxstrategist.com, it's a mix. I have a lot of copywriters on my list. Also have some business owners on my list. And for me, I always wanted to track the business owner and not necessarily the copywriter, because I don't sell too many copywriting products. And when I do sell anything copywriting related, I create the product for a business owner. I don't create it for copywriters, right? And because, in, you know, in my opinion, if you're a copywriter, there's plenty of folks out there who do advanced products and all that stuff. But I really build my stuff when it comes to anything copywriting, if they have to write sales emails or anything else. I build it towards people who are at the point in business where they don't want somebody to write their emails because they don't want to let that go. Their brand is really tied into their business. So they might have an operations manager, they may have, you know, a VA, but when it comes to the emails, they want to keep that control. So I create products for those folks. I create products for folks that have businesses but are not generating enough revenue to hire me, right? So that they can write their own emails or things like that and, you know, get enough money so maybe they could hire me or somebody else, right? And so I create my products for the person who is usually not the copywriter, but copywriters have bought my stuff and I found it really useful. Even though I don't create products for them, I create it for, you know, the other end of folks. And, you know, with that being said, the same thing with the cold email to big clients product, I'm not creating it for a copywriter. You know, I'm just not, you know, I'm not really interested in creating products for copywriters, right? You know, I like business owners. I like people who actually usually sometimes have a better mindset with money. You know, in my experience, a lot of copywriters don't. And I rather go to the people I know most likely generating money, and a lot of copywriters don't make money. So, you know, that's who I write my products for because that's where I come from. So that's always been, I think it's always interesting when I get criticized occasionally by copywriters. Oh, you should do this. I'm like, that's great for you, but you're not my audience. You're not the people I'm targeting. I don't care as much about what you say. I hear your suggestions. I listen, but I'm not going to weigh it more than my actual group of people who I really want to sell to, because I care more about their opinion on the matter. So when it comes to folks who are like copywriting fanboys and girls, like they love Gary Halbert, and every other time I speak to them, they're going to tell me about some promotion they ran, you know, or when they were in the office state or this and all this. Is like, I don't give a fuck about your opinion, you know. And I don't care because you're not my audience. Like, I wouldn't sell stuff to you. Like, you don't have the money to pay me, and I don't care. I don't. So, you know, and that's a lesson that maybe you can learn, because this is what's going to happen. And I'm going to do a caveat with this lesson, because I have taken that position of listening, because I'll listen, but I'm not going to hold what you say in higher opinion than the people who I want to attract and want to follow me. And when you take that kind of stance in anything, people get upset with you because, you know, they're in their emotions, they're in their feelings. But the truth of the matter is, there are people who've given me opinions about my stuff and they've never bought anything from me. There are people who've given me opinions about my stuff and, you know, oh, they bought the ebook that has nothing to do with, like, I wrote an ebook called The Hustler's Mind. A copywriter can use it, but it's really something I wasn't intending to write that book, but I wrote the book. And if you're a person who wants to create a side hustle or anything else, this is the kind of mentality you have to kind of think, you know, get yourself, you know, think in a certain way and getting yourself out of other mentalities, other mindsets in order to do it, because you can screw yourself over. And that's what happens a lot in business, whether it's a tiny, tiny business or it's a really big business. And, you know, for my opinion, a lot of copywriters just don't have a really good mental mentality. They don't have a mindset that is conducive for actually, you know, making money to live whatever life they're trying to live, right? I don't know what that life is. Like, I live in New York City. I don't know how many copywriters out there can afford to live in New York City, because most of them can't, right? And, you know, I say copywriters, that's one thing that I particularly do. I have the skill set to write copy. I don't say I'm a great copywriter. I don't even say I'm a good copywriter. Other people tell me I write good copy occasionally, you know. Then other people say I write shit copy occasionally. I usually say I'm good when it comes to certain things, but I've never, as of yet, when I'm in my zone, I can hit it. but it's with an audience I know very well because I put in the footwork to know that audience well enough to have a good feeling that this, I think, might work. Whether it works or not, and then I adjust from there. But you have to have a certain mentality for that, because copywriting is about trying doing a whole bunch of research, hopefully, trying something, and probably having the shit fail and blow up in your face. And then getting yourself back together, looking at what the hell actually happened, and trying to figure it out and fix it and put it out there again and see what happens. That's what copywriting is. So it's always amazing to me that you got people out there who are afraid of failure, who are afraid of making money and everything else, when you're in a business where you're most likely to fail. I give you a little stat. Agora, which is what a lot of copywriters, like at least online direct response copywriters, like to, they think Agora is Jesus or something like that. I don't know why, because there's a lot of other companies companies that make hundreds of millions of dollars a year, or multi-billion dollar companies that actually use direct response copy. But you know, they like to be, their mindset is poisoned by has-beens of copywriting and folks who are retired from copywriting but did some great things, and they did do some great things. So they can't see outside that there's a whole big world out there with lots of opportunity that are looking for copywriters with a skill set. And unfortunately, some of these copywriters out here don't know how to adapt. Like, you know, they don't know how to adapt. They don't know how to mix it in to not be such a follower of a copywriter who's in their niche, who's made their money, who makes their money, and they can't seem to follow their own path. You know, so they like to eat everybody's dog shit, you know, instead of realizing that, hey, there's other options, and maybe if I blend it, I can have more opportunity. You know, they don't want to do that, and that's fine with them. You know, so it's amazing that people get into this mindset, you know, that kind of crazy mindset to me, but yet you're literally in the business of most likely what you write or what you produce is probably going to fail. You know, that's what kills me. Like, most of the time, most marketing promotions fail. And oh, let me get back to the Agora statistics. So Agora statistic was this: according to Agora, and there's plenty of podcasts that they have people from Agora who work there who have said this, and they said about 75% of their promotions actually fail, and only 25% are actually winners. But think about that. From my understanding, if you go to work as with Agora, most of the time you don't even get to write copy when you first get there, if you're in the copywriting portion of the company, that you have to wait a year or two of learning how to research before they allow you to start writing copy. That's what I've heard on a few interviews with one of their copy chiefs there. So if that's true, and even people who are trained to be some of the best copywriters in the world only have a possible 25% chance as a company of writing successful campaign, then that says a heck of a lot, you know? So if you're writing a promotion that fails, whether you're copywriter, your business is all copywriting or not, you know, you have to be able to bounce back from that each and every time. So that's why you kind of have to have a certain mindset. You have to have grit, you know? So a hustler's mind, even though it's geared a little bit towards, slightly towards more entrepreneurship, would probably be decent for a copywriter. Why? Because you literally got to learn how to take the fact that this promotion sucked, that once it's tested, now let me give you a caveat on that. There are people out there, and I experienced this recently, where they will not even test what you have, where they'll tell you their opinion to, oh, this is shit and everything else. And I'm like, test it. You're not the market. Test the damn whatever it was. And they don't want to do it. They don't want to test it, but they got opinions. And I'm like, at the end of the day, your opinion doesn't matter. Like, I go and I'll critique people's like Facebook ads and stuff because I enjoy it. I think it's fun. And I always preface it, look, this is my view of things. This is my opinion. If this is possibly working, great. Maybe if they do these couple of changes, it might increase the way it's working. I don't know. I don't work inside that company to know the actual stats. It's an opinion. Opinions don't mean a damn thing if you haven't tested the material. So it's interesting that people are so unwilling to test and put their promotions out there, and they're literally paying nothing to do so. Unless they're printing out business cards or physical letters, you're not paying anything to send out an email, really, just an autoresponder, you know. And you could send out a bunch of promotions to test ideas to see if it'll hit. You can post on Facebook and test an idea. You can post on Instagram and LinkedIn and test an idea. Doesn't matter if the copy shit, just test it and get better. That's how you get better. You study other copywriters, see what they do, take what they tell you with their suggestions, test it, do some other stuff, test it. You know, the word test, I'm saying multiple times, there's something to it. So if you're not willing to test your copy, or if you're working with someone who's not willing to test copy at all, even though it's not costing them anything, that's probably a bad relationship. That person has a bad mindset on things, and you don't need to be working with them, because there's plenty of other companies that will test out your stuff, especially when you're both in a market where neither of you know the market. And there's really hasn't been a precedent set before where you can go, oh, well, these companies are in that market and they're really heavily catering to it. When that's not available, it's the wild, wild west. So you should test all things and see what the results of that test could possibly be for you. But if you're dealing in a situation where they don't want to do that, you're wasting your time. You know, you're wasting your time. You're wasting your time. And, you know, you need to find something else to do, which is why you should always have a backup and do what you need to do for yourself and not depend on nobody else on a lot of cases, because everybody else has their own dog shit, you know, they got to deal with. And sometimes you don't want someone smearing their dog shit on you. You know, their mindset problems, their family problems, their confidence problems on you when you are trying to make it. And this is especially true for copywriters, because online copywriters, the ones who are decent, because I know some really decent copywriters who are good people who work hard at what they do and they're really into it. Like, my thing is copy is something that I do. I'm a copywriter when I need to be. I'm a marketing consultant most of the time, a business consultant most of the time, then I am a copywriter. But for those who are really dedicated to writing copy and all that other stuff, you got to be especially careful when you got people whose mindset, they're trying to smear their bad mindset on you, because they're always glad to blame you in those scenarios. So protect yourself, because you have to have your special box of strength, because when you have a bad promotion, you have to be able to get over those feelings and, you know, work on it again. So that's my advice to any copywriter who watches this. Protect your box of safety, whatever you want to call it. Protect yourself, because you have to develop the hustler's mind. You have to develop your strength, because when you're in situations where you're running a promotion and it doesn't work out and you feel like crap, and next thing you know, you have to prepare for when the owner blames you, or when the company might you're working with get, you know, starts getting, you know, not confident in your abilities, and you become less confident in your abilities. You have to be able to go back to that place and be like, all right, you know, we fucked up, but, you know, it happens. What did we learn from this? And let's do it again, because it might be the second time or third time we'll actually hit it. So make sure you do that, because I've heard A-list copywriters like a Kim Schwamm, she actually has a product that she sells, but you got to go to her website and get it on her email list. And she talks about a couple of her failures writing copy. And she's an A-list copywriter. So it happens to everybody. Remember Agora, the company that all the copywriting gurus who's like to suck their dick for whatever reason. I don't know, because they're just people. It's just a company, in my opinion. Only 25% of their promotions as a total are successful. The rest of them don't do very well. So if they only have a success rate of 25%, what do you expect? And, you know, so have that box of safety that you can go into and, you know, do your thing. Now, that was not supposed to be what this video is about, but I'm sure there's some copywriter out there who could use it. So that was my charity event for copywriters. But as to my own stuff, yeah, I got to plan out Black Friday, man. Actually, I'm going to cut this video. Other video is going to be about Black Friday, Cyber Monday. All right. See you guys later. This is Lauren Hazel. I am the Supreme Leader H. I am Story X. Go to StoryX, BrandXStrategist.com. Get on the email list and see what kind of crazy email experiments I'm up to now. Yes, I experiment on my main list. How do you think I get decent? Because I experiment. Anyway, see you guys later. Peace.